you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
For what you are about to receive, may the Lord make you truly thankful. And I pray that I won't be the target. Remember, I am just a messenger. If you have a problem with the message, speak to him. So we're in this series. If you came for a real deep spiritual message today, I'm sorry, I'm going to disappoint you. But we are going to talk about something very, very practical, something that we can have a little chuckle over, something that we're going to be very challenged with, something by the end of the experience, you will be sat further and further down in your seat as it applies to you. I noticed Zoe's already gone. And she knew what was coming today. Well, she knew the theme of what was coming because I saw her on Friday. So it's amazing she's here. So we're thinking, I reckon she's done something about it though. I reckon, look at this water. Good for you. So we're talking about temple body care. We're talking about our bodies. And I know some of you would prefer if I didn't talk about your body. Well, I'm not talking about yours specifically. You'll be glad to hear. But we are going to talk about our bodies. And someone's got to. And I said a couple of weeks back, I really believe that pastors do not do their job and fulfill their responsibility if they don't talk about everything, body, mind, and spirit. We can be as spiritual as the rest of them, but you know, if our bodies are basically decaying because we're not looking after them, what's the point of being taught more spiritually if we haven't applied practical things to our lives? Because I don't know about you, but I need a long time down here on earth to get into here some of the stuff I need to learn and then carry it out. So I need all the time I can get. And so if there's something I can do to make sure I live longer than just to bring my life to an end because I'm not looking after my body, then I'm going to do it. So we're talking about three things really: what we put in our bodies, what we put on our bodies, and what we do with our bodies. We're basing it around two scriptures. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 19, which says, "Don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God brought you with a high price, so you must honor God with your body." So first of all, we got to understand that our bodies are temples where God, where the Holy Spirit lives. And I said to you a couple of weeks ago, because we were snowed in last week, said a couple of weeks ago that, you know, it's like if Jesus came to our physical house, we would make sure that we were nice, clean, and tidy. So what does Jesus find when he turns up in this house, in your temple? Quiet. Okay, Romans 12, verse 1. We'll move on, shall we? "And so, dear brothers and sisters," the second thought we took was from here. "So, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable." I always think that gets me thinking. So is there a way that we could actually be unacceptable in terms of our bodies? Not in terms of the fact that we've given our life to God and therefore we have a place in heaven, but is there something that we can do with our bodies that would actually make them more acceptable to God? It's not that he's not accepted us, because it says he accepts us as we are. But he never accepts us as we are to leave us as we have been. But it's to change us into what we can be and should be. And you will see as we unfold the message today how far we've got away from what we were created to be. Hold on to your seats. It's going to be a challenging ride. All right, this is truly, it says, the way to worship him. If we really want to know how to worship God, right here it says this is the way to worship him. It's not about putting our arms in the air. It's not about singing at the top of our voice. It's not about clapping our hands. They're all part of worship. But it says, listen, if you want to worship God, don't do all that and then destroy your body. Give your bodies, everything of you, to God. Don't copy. Here's the challenge. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. So the question I asked last time was this: are we building our life according to design or default? Because if we don't specifically design, we will definitely default. Remember, default means an omission of that which ought to be done, an option that is selected automatically unless an alternative is specified. So in other words, it's about living an alternative lifestyle to the rest of the world. Not the way of many, but the way of the few. I think I said last time that, you know, just because the majority of people live a certain way doesn't mean to say it's right. We have a whole world living a certain way, doesn't mean to say it's right. I've noticed things that were so terribly wrong in when I was growing up as a kid that suddenly the world is made right. And now what wasn't acceptable is acceptable. And I wonder how far we've strayed away from actually what God created us to be, especially when it comes to looking after our bodies. So we don't have to live a life according to default. We can live according to design. But it's an option. It's an option. And an option is not compulsory. So we have to choose it every day. You see, this right here, it says to transform our body, we have to change the way we think. We have to renew our minds. So in other words, whatever we've got in our minds, whatever we think about the way that we live, whatever we've defaulted to because it's been passed from one generation to another, we've got to start changing not only our thoughts, but the thoughts that we've adopted from a previous generation. That because we trusted them, we thought were right. But was Granny right? Was Granddad right? Or did he just default because of the previous generation? Now, we're not saying Granddad or Grandma was a bad person or intended to cause you a lifestyle that is not pleasing to God, but somewhere along the line, someone didn't take the bull by the horns. Someone didn't make the decision to say, do you know what, from here on, we're going to be healthy in our family. This right here is responsible for this right here. What's going on in here determines what goes in here, or should I say here, but eventually gets here. Here's the real deal. We can't blame anyone else for the way that we treat our body. We decide what we put in, we decide what we put on it, and we decide what we do with it. It's down to our choices. And are they choices that are in line with the design, or are they choices that we've just adopted or defaulted to? See, our lives are determined by the choices we make, just like we were told in Deuteronomy 30, verse 19, where it says, today, that applies to every day, I have given you the choice between life and death, between blessings and curses. And now I call on heaven and earth to witness the choice you make. Oh, that you would choose life so that you and your descendants would live. Now, don't think, well, that's the Old Testament, we're New Testament people. I've heard some stuff recently where people are going, well, you know, none of the Old Testament applies. Hey, the whole Bible applies. Now, there's some things that the New Testament has put in place that means we're not under the law of the Old Testament in the way that the Old Testament people were. But hey, there's still laws out there. There's still laws of God that we should understand and apply to our life because they actually do operate in our lives one way or the other. So, you know, here's the deal. We can say, well, we've replaced the law of our land. Well, the fact is you haven't. Whether you abide by it or not, you're going to find out if you don't actually, if you break it, you'll find out there's still a law there. And so the same with the laws of God, they still apply, but praise God, they don't actually determine whether we get to heaven. But I really believe that many of them determine what the kind of life we're going to live. I was watching, what was that program we were watching the other night with Trevor MacDonald on Death Row? And you know, there were people on death row that have made a decision not to abide by the laws of their land, and as a result are going to lose their life much earlier than God intended for them, because they made a choice to do something stupid. And most of them that were interviewed regret that choice. In one mad moment, they did something because they thought something. And we could say, well, we're not people like that. Well, we do make stupid choices just like they did. Maybe ours aren't quite as serious. But here's the thing. They have implications on us. What we put in our mouths has an implication on our body. So are we making wise choices? Do we honestly know the truth? Or are we believing something that's been passed down the centuries from generation to generation? Hosea 4 verse 6 says, my people are ruined because they don't know what's right or true. I believe that's more true today than it ever was. Do we really know what the truth is about what we're doing in our lives? It's actually easier to carry on believing lies that go back years and start believing truth that goes back to the beginning. Because continuing to believe lies doesn't demand a change of lifestyle. Anything that demands a change of lifestyle is going to be challenging. But here's the thing, no pain, no gain. And it's true when it comes to basically making that decision. And we have a choice to make. There's two places we can live, in the stream of truth or on the river called denial. Boom, boom. If we continue to live in denial, then the truth can't help us. We can quote the Bible all day long, and the truth will set me free, but it's not because we're not applying it. It's one thing to know the truth. Someone can tell you, don't eat that food. But if you eat it, then you're going to understand why someone told you not to eat it. But we have to apply the truth. Until we apply it, someone else knowing it is not helping us. We've got to believe it for ourselves and apply it for ourselves. So we get into this first thing, what we put in our bodies. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12. So you didn't know that the Bible was so practical, did you? Tells us what to eat. Says just because something is technically legal doesn't mean that it's spiritually appropriate. Wow, I could stop right there and just preach another message. If I went around doing whatever I thought I could get away with, I'd be a slave to my whims. You know the old saying, first you eat to live, and then you live to eat. Well, it may be true that the body is only a temporary thing, but that's no excuse for stuffing your body with food or indulging it with sex. Since the master honors you with a body, honor him with your body. I love the message. It's so straight between the eyes in the language that we understand. And I think that line says it all for me. First, you eat to live. And then it's not very long before you start to live to eat. Lois was just showing me a picture this morning of a guy that's died in the States. And the hearse and all the funeral procession had to go through his favorite restaurant where he went, I guess, every day. Burger King, and they decided that they would take the hearse and the whole funeral procession through, and what they did in honor of this guy, they all had a Whopper, and they put a Whopper on his coffin. Here's the truth, every abuse of health quickens death. Whatever we put in our mouth either builds health or creates disease. And just in case you're thinking right now, because I've used an illustration of Burger King and an American guy, and automatically your thoughts are thinking, you know, well, that applies to Americans. We know that they eat too much and they're overweight. And yes, that's true. It does apply to Americans. But here, it applies to us. And if you knew where we are going as a society, as a nation, you would see this applies to us just as much. Research from Oxford University, by the way, that's in the UK, just in case you think that's Oxford University somewhere else. No, it's in the UK. Showed the average man was 17 pounds heavier in the year 2000 than he was in 1986. 17 pounds. Women were not much better, with an average weight gain of 12 pounds over the same period. While men have put on weight due to poor diet and lack of exercise, women have piled on the pounds by simply eating too much. The latest health survey for England data in 2010 shows that 62.8% of adults, that means over 16, were overweight or obese. We're talking about this country. 62.8%, just say that so it impacts you, 62.8% of our adult population in 2010, so this figure's probably gone up, were overweight or obese. Listen to this, 30.3% of children, that's between the age of 2 and 15, were overweight or obese. A survey published in 2012 for the NHS found that just over a quarter of all adults, 26% in England, are obese. Obesity is also an increasing problem in children because around 1 out of 7 children are classified as obese. By 2050, obesity is predicted to rise dramatically if healthy lifestyles are ignored. It's predicted that 60% of all adult men, 50% of adult women, and 25% of children will be obese. Now, I'm not talking overweight, I'm talking obese. You have these different guidelines as to what is overweight and what's obese. We're not even looking at the obese, the overweight section. Listen to this. This breaks my heart. Gastric bypass operations are already now reportedly costing the NHS £85 million a year in the UK. And yet there are still children dying from starvation and malnutrition in the third world. Something is terribly wrong. The British Heart Foundation, which commissioned a study into obesity, said research suggests obesity is a ticking time bomb for health. It's a major risk factor for diabetes, heart disease, and stroke, and contributes to premature death and poor quality of life. See, just like that scripture said, just because something's legal doesn't mean to say it's right, good, or appropriate. Here's the bottom line, really. Our bodies were designed with certain food in mind. To make it easier for us to understand, because I don't want there to be any confusion, when we're thinking about what our bodies were basically designed to be able to handle, it's down to this one thing. Anything natural, not man-made. It's when the food is processed, modified, or man-made that problems begin, because basically we lose what's good and we gain what's bad. In fact, let me give you a simple rule of thumb, because often I get asked, because we've applied this over the last 2.5 years now, as we've developed a healthy lifestyle that goes from eating to exercise, and we're continuing to do that. It's not a diet. We keep saying to people, we have not gone on a diet. We have changed our lifestyle. And here's the thing. I do not miss what we've given up. I really don't miss some of the things that we've given up. Here's a simple rule of thumb. To only eat food that grew out of the ground or once had a face. Simple rule of thumb. Or you can go caveman and think like the hunter-gatherer. When looking at something on the supermarket shelf, ask yourself this question. Would have it existed in the Stone Age? Someone else said this. Stick to the outer aisles of the supermarket. There's a reason that they are on, the food there is on the outer aisles, because it needs changing a lot quicker, because it will go off. That means because it will go off, because it will rot, it's healthier for you. So the daily decision really is natural versus man-made. The easy part is knowing. The hard part is practicing. And especially when man-made food looks so attractive. Do you realize why they have to make it look so attractive? So that you will buy it. I mean, I was talking the other day, I think it was Friday, and we were saying that there's a hotel that we'd seen online, and they were showing their conference center, and I have never been so attracted to an apple. They had this boardroom with all these tables, and they had these nice glasses on the table, and they had their pen and their pad for a conference, and they had a real big, rosy, red, shined-up apple. It was drawing me in. I was like, oh, I so want an apple right now. But with most natural food, how do you make it look nice? Of course the box of the processed food is going to look attractive, because if they just gave you a white box, even though what might be in the box might be good for you, which it's not, you wouldn't buy it. So they make it as attractive as possible. Think about it. What a waste, because you are going to chuck the box within a few days, a few weeks. All that trouble they went to get you to buy something when really they could have given you a cardboard box, but they know that you wouldn't have bought anything in that way. That's the problem. When they package it and process it and market and mess with it, it's hard to resist. I know chocolate talks. That wrapper just talks to you. The great thing is, if you change your lifestyle, you can actually eat certain chocolate. Now, I eat dark chocolate. Now, before some of you feel like throwing up right now, you have to understand, I never liked dark chocolate. I thought it was gross. And I gradually tried it and got my mind over the matter of chocolate. And now if you give me milk chocolate, I want to throw up. So you can change. And you work your way up to the 80% cocoa, by the way. You don't just go all in. I mean, don't just go for it, because it's going to make you throw up. But, you know, if we're talking about natural versus man-made, let's take these two bottles. So here is water. The chemical properties in water are H2O. This, on the other hand, the man-made alternative, by the way, there is a product, I should have really got it, but I don't want to be sued. I'll hold my hand over this label as well, but, oh, everybody's seen it now. Anyway, I'm not talking specifically about this brand today, I'm talking about what's in this bottle, and many other brands exist. But there is something we grew up with. It's an energy drink that used to just be a drink that you took to make you feel better when you didn't feel so good. And it starts with L. And if you've seen the advert, they've got this row of runners on the running machine, and they show all these guys falling over, drinking water, drinking other energy drinks. And the last guy keeps going right to the end. Everybody else has collapsed. And then the line is that this drink energizes you, rehydrates you, better than, but the tagline that you're going to hear is not rehydrate, you're going to hear is better than water. But all you're going to hear is this, if this was that particular drink, is better than this. And there are going to be people that are going to go and drink this rather than that. The chemical properties of this, CO2, and a whole load of other chemicals that we don't have time to mention, but I'm going to tell you what they do to you. Now, no one would suggest that you drink CO2 when you can drink H2O. Here's the thing about water that's so amazing, that God created our bodies in such a way that our bodies know exactly what to do with water. It basically uses it and cannot store it as fat. Which is why when you drink water, you probably will want to go to the toilet a lot quicker than you drink in other drinks. Why? Because it doesn't store it. It's going to go right through you. It's going to do some good on the way, but it's going to go through you. Take C-O-K-E for, on the other hand, we call it C-O-K. So this is H2O, and this is C-O-K. This, your body is going, what's this? I don't know what to do with this. And when it doesn't know what to do with it, the default that it will apply is basically it will store fat because it doesn't know what to do. It will just store it as fat. It's looking at it going, well, I don't know. I won't take the top off, by the way, just in case some of you are getting really nervous. The fact that it will do that probably says quite a lot too. Here's the thing about water. Let's concentrate on the good stuff for a minute. Let's make you positive before we go negative. All right, we can live for a few months without food. But you know, we can only last 10 days without water. Next to the air that we breathe, water is the most important element. Every life-giving and healing process that happens inside of our body happens with water. Most experts insist that 75% of Americans are chronically dehydrated and should drink more water. In 37% of Americans, the thirst mechanism is so weak that it's often mistaken for hunger. Hence the reason for there being so many drive-through places and restaurants in the States. Even mild dehydration will slow down one's metabolism as much as 3%. Just by you not drinking water. One glass of water shut down midnight hunger pangs for almost 100% of the dieters studied in a University of Washington study. 100% result. One glass of water shut down their hunger pangs. So when you feel hungry and you've stayed up too long and you know you've stayed up too long because you're feeling hungry, instead of going to the fridge, instead of going to the cupboard, now you're beginning to hate me, aren't you? You need to go and get some water out the tap rather than food out the cupboard, because what your body is trying to tell you is, listen, you need more of this. But your brain is saying, no, I need that bag of crisps. I need that chocolate bar. I need that bowl of cereal. I need that kebab. I need that. That was for Si. Lack of water is the number one trigger of daytime fatigue. If you feel fatigued during the day, that's going to be the number one trigger. Research indicates that 8 to 10 glasses of water a day could significantly ease back and joint pain for up to 80% of sufferers. How many people are taking pills and potions and all sorts of stuff that isn't doing their body any good when all they really need to do is drink a little bit more of this? A mere 2% drop in body water can trigger fuzzy short-term memory, trouble with basic maths, and difficulty focusing on a computer screen or a printed page. This one is astonishing. Drinking 5 glasses of water daily decreases the risk of colon cancer by 45%. It can slash the risk of breast cancer by 79%, and one is 50% less likely to develop bladder cancer. Why do we need convincing when those kind of facts are out there? I mean, if we just had some more of this. And I know that some of you are going to go, I don't like it. My wife literally starts to gag when she drinks water. So she has to pace it, or she has to put some kind of flavor in it, whether it just be a juice or something. And I reckon eventually that will go. Her body will actually start to change and really thirst for this real natural stuff. So that's water. That's positive. Let's talk about this stuff. Oh, please don't. The only thing that this is really good for, and we're talking about Coke. We're talking about the drink Coke. So just in case, because I know how minds work. Oh, well, you only talked about that particular brand, so I can get away with the other one that starts with P. No, they're all the same. We're talking generally about Coke. And just for my hairdresser, if he's watching, we're not talking about cocaine, okay? We're just talking about the drink. Talking to him on Friday, he thought I was talking about cocaine today. That would be a totally different message. Anyway, the only thing that Coke is really good for, wait for it, and I wish I could have brought one today, is the toilet. Yes, if you pour a can of Coke or a bottle of Coke on a stained toilet, leave it for an hour, the citric acid will clean and remove stains from your china bowl. Or another good use, because there are some good uses. If you're going to buy it, there's some good uses. You can clean corrosion from car battery terminals. Pour a can of Coke over the terminals and it will evidently bubble away the corrosion. Two good uses, but neither of them are going in here. It's also an engine cleaner. Car engine, truck engine, just any old engine, but not this one. In fact, Coca-Cola have evidently been cleaning their engines with it for 20 years or more. To carry the Coca-Cola syrup, the concentrate, a commercial trucker must display the hazardous material symbol reserved for highly corrosive materials. In many states in the USA, it's reported that highway patrol cars carry 2 gallons of Coke in the boot or in the trunk to remove blood from the highway after a car accident. So lots of good uses, but none of them in our body. Not shocked enough yet? By the way, I'm going to keep holding it because I just want this to be the constant. Listen to this. The active ingredient in here is phosphoric acid, a major contributor to the rising increase in osteoporosis. Its pH is 2.8. It's believed it will dissolve a nail in about 4 days. It's reported, and there's always people, by the way, if you go and Google this, you're going to find some that, well, I tried that and it didn't work. I don't care whether it works or not. Someone to put it out there is enough for me to go, do you know what? It's not got good stuff in it. And whether it does these things or not, there must be some truth in it for people to put these things on there. If you put a T-bone steak in a bowl of Coke, they say that it will be gone in 2 days. And to think that maybe even some of you are putting that in your body, my question is, what's it doing to your T-bone steak? What's it doing to some of your body parts? Because if we're talking about a steak, it came out of an animal, it was a body part. What's it doing to yours? It's certainly not doing any good. Here's the other thing I read. They did a test on some rats, and rats developed cancer. And they said, well, it was such a low amount that it won't actually affect human beings. And therefore, these drinks got passed by the FDA in America, where they've originated from, and that's why we have them over here. Listen, if it killed anything, I don't want to drink it. Now, I know this is challenging, because I want to tell you, this is addictive. That's why you're going to find it hard to give it up, because it's like anything. You can be addicted to coffee, you can be addicted to this. Why not be addicted to this? This can't do you any harm, and I know there'll be some who will be pedantic and say, oh, well, we've got fluoride in our, you know, and there's stuff in our pipes. Listen, I don't think that's anywhere near as damaging as what you're going to put in your body if you start or keep putting this in. We know that kids' teeth are not good because of all this stuff and other stuff too, but hey, this is good. This is good. I don't think I'm convincing anybody, that's the problem, but it is good. Here's the real deal. Natural foods were made for our God-given body, and the God-given body was made for natural foods, so it knows what to do with them. Whereas if you just actually throughout the day had certain meals, and breakfast being the most important one, and I know I'm sounding like your mother now, but it's true. All of those kind of things, there is still truth in them, and that truth is never going to go away because it's biblical. But what he didn't do is say, here's food, just eat it however you want. And that's where, over the years, we've defaulted. So what we basically do is we put meat, milk, starch, fat, and sugar in our body all at the same time, in one meal, right? You think about it, meat, milk, starch, fat, and sugar. That's like pouring petrol, diesel, oil, and honey into your fuel tank of your car. We wouldn't do that to our car. So why do we do it to our body?
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.